Before I even start the video, guys, I am not trying to take sides. I am only simply trying to reframe the side of Doc's story. Yes, he has finally come out with a full video. I will link it down below for all of you. I'm going to give you a shortened response of his in summary of what he is trying to say about his entire past, all those accusations. Certainly, we can all agree on one thing. Of all the CSGO up-and-coming pro players, I should say, who knows what his future is going to hold. He has one of the more mysterious pasts against him. I've talked about him probably over the past 3 years of my career, if you want to call it that. I'm not trying to side with people against him, and I'm not necessarily trying to side with Doc either, simply trying to share his side with all of you, because I can never convince all of you guys of everything. You either choose to believe Doc's word, or you choose to believe Richard Lewis and other people's words against him. There are certainly many against him and many with him in his very, very controversial past, I should say, and he has now finally come forward about at least some of the things he has been accused of. And either way, I do want to be honest with you guys. I wish him the best of luck. I myself am a fan of his, and I tend to lean towards his story, but again, there's really no way for either side to fully convince me of who is right and who is wrong, because there are just countless accusations and countless storylines. Let's just try and cover what Doc had to say, stretching all the way back to the initial accusations of one of his Steam accounts, or several Steam accounts being linked to him, which also have bans inside the game of Counter-Strike. He actually mentions early on his story where apparently it was his dad who owned his first ever Steam account. Eventually it was Doc who kind of got sick of that, got sick of asking for the password and not actually having his own account. Later on, he actually tried to share a Steam account with a person he had met online, and in exchange, they shared the Steam account, and that person he had met bought him a copy of Counter-Strike. Not too much further down the line, apparently they met a third person known as Flogs. I'm not really sure the pronunciation is correct. I will call him Flogs, and it was actually the three of them who started playing Counter-Strike together, until the three of them shortly after got in a fight, and eventually the guy who bought him Counter-Strike, they shared that same Steam account, then shared those details with this person known as Flogs, who eventually got the account, according to Doc, an Overwatch ban. But it was actually Richard Lewis calling this Flogs, right? The person who apparently got Doc or one of his initial Steam accounts Overwatch banned, he called him a cheat code maker or a cheat coder. Doc has now come back and said no, he was only 12 years old at the time. It was highly unlikely, albeit, guys, what this does boil down to is Doc saying that Flogs was not a cheat maker and Richard Lewis saying he was. Either side not really showing, I would say, substantial proving evidence of their ground. So it really comes down to, do you believe Richard or do you believe Doc? Either way, that's fully up to you. Now, his grind does continue, though, as he actually started pugging more and more, going on to Face It, ESEA, grinding for rank G, eventually trying to get rank S. And here is where other accusations came into play of him actually being DDoSed. What Doc actually said was a lot of people out there accusing him of being a cheater, and thus sequentially after a lot of people trying to DDoS him, eventually he was given a 5-year initial ban by ESEA for apparently being associated with DDoSers. Again, not much evidence shown on either side here. Eventually, his ban was reduced from 5 years to 1 year, and he was completely okay with that, according to his own words. Although he does make sure to mention he still stands he was completely innocent, and there's no way that ESEA could go back entirely on their 5-year punishment, because it would make them look back to actually charge him with a 5-year ban of doing something that he supposedly had not done, and then to revert the entire ban. Not really sure how I feel about on that one. We've seen a lot of platforms out there issue bans and take them back, but certainly we've also seen plenty of platforms, to Doc's point here, we've seen plenty of platforms out there actually give out bans and then reduce them, even though the player or person accused might indeed be innocent. If you guys do want an example, I've been talking about TF Blade in the past, a League of Legends streamer. He was actually accused of saying the N-word. Twitch initially gave him a 30-day ban. After further review, they reduced his ban to 2 weeks. They didn't fully take it back. So before you guys say that Doc's word here does not have a lot of weight, there are certainly plenty of platforms out there who do issue bans, eventually find out that player or person is innocent, and still leave a partial ban to save face a little bit. So you gotta understand both sides. Then later on, guys, he heads back to Face It. Further accusations around all of this kind of stuff. He eventually gets kicked from Face It for not using a mic. He tried to use the text-to-speech program, as I'm sure a lot of you, if you guys are diehard viewers or diehard fans, even of his, you probably remember this. He did actually try to play the top level of Face It Challenger with a text-to-speech program. Also, at one point, tried to actually stream his games to a friend who would then make the in-game callouts for him. He actually tried streaming on Mixer, a private stream, so only he and a person with a URL could access it, with a very, very short delay, and that's how he was trying to make callouts. It didn't last much longer before he was actually kicked slash benched from the program, eventually invited back when he one day started using his microphone. Around the same time, though, before he was actually invited back and not using his microphone, he did actually come up with, I wouldn't even call it an excuse, you know, it was his statement to say he actually lived in a very reserved home, and apparently it was with him and 5 other people, or at least many people in the same home as possible. By the way, people who were already disturbed by the amount of Counter-Strike he was playing, and thus that's why he was not using in-game comms to try and avoid disturbing them all the more. And I really can't speak to this too much because, you know, there are plenty of households out there that probably would not allow their kids to be playing this much, and especially if they're yelling comms or saying comms repeatedly in game. And if they are, supposedly maybe one of them, like he said in the past, I do believe was actually working from home. If he didn't want to disturb them, that's his own case, right? This is another point that we cannot fully prove whether or not he is wrong or right here. We don't live in the household. We don't know those exact guidelines. I will say some of his excuses in the past obviously have been suspicious, but there's no way for us to fully know whether or not he is telling the truth. And thus there's no way for us to actually fully call him, you know, guilty in all of this. It's why it's very, very tough circumstance as you dive into all the little itty bitty minor details that no one besides Doc actually knows the truth of. So he eventually does get invited back, guys. Yes, there was also the time, I believe it was Chris J invited him to come over, you know, live stream, webcam, mic'd up and everything. We've also seen ever since then, Doc has competed, I believe at one LAN event by now as well. And he's competed for several teams as well. I don't know what his future might be as terms of a Counter-Strike pro. We go to his most recent allegation. It's not even an allegation. It was actually a face it ban as well for playing with a known face it cheater. The way Doc explains this one is actually, funnily enough, when we covered this story for all of you, I had no idea. And now we do know this is actually from face it matches over 8 months ago that were then reported after the fact. It was actually Doc saying he was playing with one of his friends. He and her were actually playing with that third member who was Mickey, who was actually the supposed face it cheater. They played a couple pugs with the guy, did not think he was cheating. After the fact, though, it was actually Doc's friend. She had a new boyfriend. Apparently, Mickey, the cheater, did not enjoy that. He went back 8 months to those matches because he is a face it banned account, then reported those matches with him in it, and thus everyone got banned 8 months later. Did that make sense to all of you? So when that face it ban has now surfaced, I believe it was a 1 month long ban for Doc and his friends actually playing with a known face it cheater. Those matches that actually happened where they were playing with a cheater only happened a few times were 8 months ago. And it was because that cheater got very upset because the girl they were playing with found a new boyfriend. So he went back and reported his own matches. Yeah, the stuff you just don't know. And so with all of that being said, and again, even this video will not touch on all the finite details I remember from the past of this, because it would just take an incredible amount of work to actually come up with all those details for one single video, especially with the fact that Doc also brings up a lot of Richard Lewis's blank allegations in this same video. So again, if you guys want to watch Doc's full video, I will link it down below. I suggest captions as well for some of the smaller pronunciations of names involved. Whether or not you want to believe him, guys, it really is up to you as well. The story of Doc to me is continuously going to be very interesting. It kind of sucks to say this, but I feel like the one and the best way that a guy like Doc can actually prove himself to be legitimate would be to come up and actually be, you know, a top tier pro, play for an established team yet again, and actually compete on LAN. Will that happen? I just have no idea. All these connected accounts, all these backstories, it certainly does lend its way to a lot of theories to be made by the community. And it really comes down to who do you believe. If you trust Doc, you know, that's the end of it. If you don't, then so be it. If he can prove himself innocent one day, I hope him the best and wish him the best of luck as well. Until next time, hope you guys all enjoy breaking down CSGO esports gaming news here every single day, all day long. Until next time, take care. I'll see you guys back here sometime soon.